Buenas tardes, gracias por estar acá. El plan de esto es tener una conversación con un formato relativamente abierto. La conversación la vamos a hacer en inglés. Les cuento un poco, la idea es, con Martin tenemos dos preguntas preparadas también para iniciar la conversación con nuestros invitados. Nuestros invitados son Danny Miller de University College of London y Miller from California Irvine, ambos antropólogos. En el contexto de la exhibición de Soledad Houston en el medio de las cosas, por lo cual le llamamos a esta actividad muy originalmente antropología en el medio de las cosas. Pero la idea es también un poco conversar sobre por qué pusimos ese nombre y de qué se trata esto. Entonces, como les contaba, vamos a partir con estas dos preguntas para luego abrir la conversación a quien tenga otra pregunta. La idea es que dure alrededor de una hora. La conversación va a ser en inglés. Sin embargo, si es que alguno necesita alguna ayuda, por ejemplo, para hacer una pregunta con traducción, o más, no tenemos ningún problema con iniciarla o con traducir. Entonces, estamos. Here we are. So just the first question is, you are both part of a generation of anthropologists where everyday life object is central. There has been a lot of reflection and research about that. And you are, in your own work, there is a specific attention that I have seen. That is, work produces a lot about material culture and how we live among these type of objects. And you have been working a lot about perhaps the most abstract but also practical things that is running. And we are here in the context of service exhibition that is an artistic reflection about this everyday life object. So just to start the conversation, I would like to ask you both, what do you think about potential crossovers between anthropological reflection about these types of things and artistic and other types of disciplinary, like sociology, seeing architecture, design, and so on?
Thank you very much for the invitation, and of course, we both are sort of delighted to be able to see the exhibition and to be able to reflect on it in your company. And you're quite right that one of the things that we have worked on is a time when anthropology has increasingly not just paid attention to material culture, but has been interested in why this has tended to be neglected, particularly in the tradition of anthropology itself. And what that implies is that irony, that on one hand objects seem so kind of evidently there and present, and yet the implication is that we fail to see them. We kind of go through them and pass them, we don't actually stop and reflect, and therefore we have diminished the sense of their presence as part of culture and cultural generally. And what I thought was particularly interesting about the exhibition was that we could say that in general terms, and then we might start looking at, say, clothing or toys or some other set of objects. But it seemed to me that the exhibition actually took that point to an extreme, because of all the kinds of objects that you don't see, it is the kind that might be left behind by a workman, the little bits of machinery that are no longer of any interest or use. They are never normally, you took objects that are not going to be iconic. They're not going to be seen as particularly representing anything in particular, and would fall through the cracks, I think, even of kind of the normal material culture studies. So it seemed that as one might open marks, takes it to the point that's coming out of material culture studies, but by kind of taking it to the extreme, makes the point profoundly. So I would say thank you for that.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, very much thank you for the work, and thank you for inviting us here. I'll echo Andy's comments there. What's fascinating to me, too, when encountering the work for the first time, because Danny and I literally just walked in and there it was, we had never seen it before, is I certainly think we both have this experience of first, not just what is it, what are we seeing, but how is it made, what is it made out of? Because it's really quite confounding when you encounter that the material of the work itself, because some of it looks so much like metal, like sheet metal, you know, industrial product, when in fact it's all made of paper and all layer upon layer of prints that she's made and then cut up and reassembled into three-dimensional objects. And so what's interesting there to me is that these are both objects, or you know, these objects that represent things that, as Danny said, are almost the kind of throwaway bits of consumer culture, some of the detritus or the refuse, but also the infrastructure or the old or no longer used infrastructure. So there's a box there that represents a device that would run an embroidery machine. So it's the infrastructure that then produces the embroidery that makes the cloth, that makes the fashion. But we're several steps removed from it. It looks old, it looks like it might be in disrepair, so it looks like it might be a kind of part of a former infrastructure that's no longer in service. And similarly with the exhaust fans, I thought were fascinating, that the whole area off to the far corner of the room where there are exhaust fans, pulley and various other kinds of mechanical things that a gas cylinder that look like something in a workman's shop, but it's not a workman, you know, it's not a workman who would be out here necessarily in an auto repair shop, but you know, a workman in an even more peripheral place who's using items, reusing items that probably have been reused themselves, several steps away from their initial purpose and toward the making of something new. And what is that something new that imagined person is producing, right? We're invited to reflect on that. We're invited to reflect on what is it that the assemblage of items here themselves cast off from another era of industrial production are now making, what kind of objects of desire are they making. And that to me is fascinating because it brings in both the subject matter of the exhibit, and also the very manner in which you made these things.
To follow up, I mean, something struck me, like, this is not really about your intention, but it's the impact it made upon the thinking of you having about the way manufacture and our relationships, the size of relationship to manufacture, is the fact that you've made it essentially, most of the objects, you've taken what might have been 3D objects and essentially reduced, sort of deconstructed into series of layers. Yeah. So you actually juxtapose the whole series of layers, sometimes actually plaster one upon another, or sometimes with the gaps between them. So the idea of an object being made out of a series of layers is what really is prominent in the way you produce it. Now, I happen to think that is extraordinarily interesting at this particular moment. And the reason is that it speaks to what is likely to be one of the most radical transformations of our relationship to objects in human history that is probably about to happen. And just to elaborate on that, we tend to think of the manufacture as something that once upon a time was more kind of artisanal and therefore more domestic. It happened in people's homes, and people were more, once upon a time, more responsible for making the things that they generally used. And then we have an industrial revolution, and that will then get taken from the domestic arena and put into sites of specifically of manufacture, which is factories, workshops, etc. Apart from maybe making jam, domestic production tended to kind of fade away. Now, there have been a number of articles recently suggesting that this whole thing is about to reverse in a way that your objects speak to very precisely. And this is because of the invention of something called a three-dimensional printer. And the three-dimensional printer has been around for a while, but it's now down to about, I think, $1,500 mark. And it's coming into play more seriously. And the point about a three-dimensional printer is it actually prints by juxtaposing layers, plastic layers, one on top of the other. So you make us aware of the degree to which a three-dimensional object actually can be used on layers, and that I think is actually going to be, in a sense, I think you predicted the future. Because I think that actually is going to become far more important. What that then represents is potentially the re-domestication of manufacture. Things that at the moment we have to go to the shops for, or rely on factories or workshops, we are going to be able to sort of digitally get the kind of movement for, etc. And just print it out in our garage or print it out in our homes. And I think everybody's kind of wondering just to what degree that will happen. But also what difference it will make in our relationship to ordinary objects, because then we could, in our own homes, for example, be like you have been, which is rather more creative. Rather than just buying something as a ready-made from the shop, we would presumably be able to get the basics of it and then transform it a little bit, put your personal crest on it, or whatever it is that you would like to do. And that kind of creative, re-artisanal kind of domestic work is something that, to one of the correct metal, I thought this is the future. That layer is going to be extremely important in reconfiguring our relationship to manufactured objects in the future.
If I could just recount some of our own conversation downstairs earlier, Danny had actually asked Soleil if she had used a three-dimensional printer for any of it. And her response was, this is my printer.
Quite remarkable. Yeah, the three-dimensional printer is very expensive.
Yeah.
In Chile, there is only one.
Oh, really?
But Paraíso, it works with glue and panda. So, and you need a special program. It's not that, but a 3D
program. Prediction is that it's like computers. These are one of those things where when you first saw a computer, when you first saw the internet, there was one, as it were, in Chile, but there is at least the possibility that this is going to become something that almost everybody would expect to have in their home. I don't know if that's true or not, but it's, if it's $1,500 now, it's certainly starting to come down towards levels at which it may become a regular object. That's the definition.
But there's kind of a polysemy though in the work too, right? Because one can both see this and imagine this kind of technological future that re-domesticates manufacture through a piece of sophisticated technology. But at the same time, one also sees resonances with the crafting movement, with the DIY, with the do-it-yourself movement, and with people that are trying to reflect critically on the history of industrial manufacture in its wake, in the wake of its end, in the wake of its ends, its multiple plural ends, as it's all falling apart. And yet, even as it's all falling apart, there's still that part of, who needs his tools, the hoses and tools, and there's still the essentially artisanal, I kind of imagine an artisanal auto mechanic, who needs his gas cylinder and is going to be hooking that up to something to run a generator. There's still the way that people essentially hack into and reroute existing infrastructures, like in the Taiwanese window mounted on the wall, you can see some kind of cable sneaking its way around and through that probably was a kind of auto-constructed electrical grid or something like that. So it really is fascinating that the work brings together both this kind of detritus of the industrial era and a gesture toward manufacturing.
I think that this temporality that the exhibition really relates to is also interesting in the sense of how this then gets picked up by you as art. Because one has a sense that, I remember reading a long time ago an essay by George Zimmerman, The Ruin. And the sense of, why do we find a ruin attractive as an aesthetic object, in the sense that if it's sort of something that's just gone out of commission, as it were, it doesn't attract us in that kind of romantic guise. If it's something that's completely disintegrated, usually also. But there's a certain kind of stage of ruination. And it seems to me that if we're having to reflect forward, if we're reflecting now back, the kind of objects you've got down there, seem to be. Some of them are come from previous decades, but mostly you're using the kind of patina. And patina seem very important in the colours and the sort of textures of the objects you've got. And I think that the patina speaks to that notion of ruin as something that we find attractive in the greens that come out and the rust that comes out. And the kind of colours that weren't, in a sense, ever necessarily supposed to be there, but objectors use, but speak to temporality itself as a theme coming out of material culture. It seemed to me that that was something you were trying to capture. It was a recoloration of the objects in the way you took them and then used them in your own art.
Yeah, I think you're right. And maybe when people started printing their own objects, maybe they will not get that.
Not
because then there will be their objects, but there will be new.
Yeah.
It's this way in which that patina indexes use and indexes histories of use that makes it so compelling, I think, right? Because then you're no longer just seeing an object, but you're seeing an object that's always been enmeshed in a whole host of social relationships and mechanical relationships and organizational histories, one imagines. And the different patterns of wear that you see on those items and all point back to that. And that's, Jose had started off asking about the relationship of all of this to anthropology or the history of anthropology, and it makes me think back to, you know, very early Malinowski stuff and his, you know, the Coral Gardens book almost, you know, the descriptions of Malinowski of some of the material culture of the appropriate islands where he's focus on things like how knots are made in time, how they come undone, and what the time doing says about the relationship.
In terms of other kind of anthropological approaches, there's a lot of debates currently around material culture associated with people like, say, Latour, Miguel, etc., is about this social contextualization of the object on one hand, and then the degree to which the object either escapes or autonomously from that expresses a sort of agency. And Patino kind of seems to be expressive of that. These once upon a time, kind of lived and were used within the social context and certainly speak to the memory of that context, but left as your object seemed to be, like in a workshop where there wasn't any point taking it back and hoping to use it again. It's kind of parted, it wasn't likely to be used, it was broken, etc. That's when, in a sense, they start to change colour, do things in and of themselves. We don't reflect on any kind of intentionality, and I think that kind of theoretical argument that's going on now at the moment about agency and autonomy and the object itself, in a way, it's as though these objects are speaking to that as well.
Absolutely.
Because they're doing all these things. Nobody planned them to do these things. Nobody saw them in terms of that light. There's waste. One of the projects I'm engaged in moment is a project called The Waste of the World. And what we're trying to do in this work is that normally waste is seen as the end. You use a project and ultimately it is waste. And actually, there's all sorts of things that are going on where waste is the start of a new cycle of production. So, for example, clothing was reduced down to shodding, rewoven as clothing. Ships have broken up and then the material is used for something else. And I think that I think that partly because of environmental issues, etc., one of the things that we are starting to look at with a different eye is waste. And clearly that's, I'm sure, one of the intentions of your work. You're taking something that would be particularly disregarded in its capacity as waste and actually saying, look at it. What is this? What is this now, amongst other things, inspiration from artwork?
Thank you very much for the invitation. As Scott was saying, you both share this study of the marginality of the quotidian and these things that we usually don't see because they're so obvious. And because they're so obvious, it's when you create them in a place like a gallery that it is much easier for us to project. I want to move a little bit from the exhibition itself, and also move a little bit away from the idea that the quotidian is our everyday life within our homes or everyday life in our workplace or with our families, sharing time and place, the co-potential. Because you both share also this interest in the quotidian that is taking place now, not only in this microcosms, but within this wider transnational quotidian, as in, for example, transnational relationships with kin, transnational relationships. Well, you both work in these things today, and my question is, starting from this idea of the quotidian within the transnational, how this cozy, like homey thing, but it's much more like modern thing to study that is the transnational. Then we'll go to the more specific transnational things we can study. But,
there's something that we've both been doing for a number of years, and Danny, for much longer than I, which is that we constitute larger groups of people to help us do the work and with whom we do the work as collaborators. And I think that that's one just very simple answer to how one can study things like transnational relationships of any kind, financial, kins, commodity production, meaning production, or value. One can deploy a lot of people and have forums where people can come together and talk about it. But I think for me, I'm still teaching my students and saying to the people that I work with that the discipline's hallmark of very close attention to tiny things still remains unbelievably relevant. And then the challenge then becomes seeing how all of those tiny things that are very quotidian, are very mundane, are often very boring, right? They don't seem that particularly interesting until you bring someone in and show them, look at how fascinating this is. But to still focus on those very small things and build them up into the larger picture. I mean, I'm just thinking back down to the gallery again. There's a moment that I had where at first I kind of saw industrial detritus, but then you notice, oh, this thing in the back here is written in Arabic, and this other thing says something about Lebanon in French, right? And you start to see in the little tiny pieces these other relationships standing out from them. So, to the extent that, that work can be a sort of metaphor for the way that we can feel right now, I think it's quite appropriate to think about getting from micro to macro with lots and lots of collaborators.
I think that there's actually quite an important very direct relationship between the two things that you were asking about, which is that we live in a world of increasingly transnational life. Split couples, refugees, migrant labour, etc. And the question really is what does us trying to pay attention to the quotidian objects speak to? And I think that it's important because the problem with the tendency where academics look at the transnational is that we tend to focus not on that, but on the things that speak to what we want to see as the issue. So we look at identity. Or we look at, is this person relating to the things that belong to the place they came from, or the things that evidently belong to the place that they're now in, and what does that say about the power relations between these things? So we tend to sort of build up the things that would have been important to the theoretical structures that we project onto that situation. But actually, for people who today live transnational lives, it may be that what we're missing is the importance of the quotidian to them. So for example, I've recently been doing a lot of work on blue jeans. And blue jeans, I think, is interesting precisely because of that particular aspect, he says. But nobody, you know, although it's half of what probably people here are aware of, nobody really studies them because they're just too evident to them. And yet, it struck me that for transnational migrants in particular, people living transnational lives, quotidian objects are actually extremely important. And the reason they're important is those objects do not speak to those questions. If like Charlie wears blue jeans, it's not, oh, do blue jeans represent somewhere in Africa they come from, or do they represent women? They don't represent either. They are beneath the surface of having to choose about aspects of identity or power, and in a way, they allow people, actual migrants, to relax beneath the level of you're supposed to be this or you're supposed to be that, or what might call the burden of identity, and actually relate themselves to an array of the quotidian which everybody shares, where which really doesn't necessarily express those issues of power. So the sort of, you know, the oil can and the bits of zinc fencing and etc. is often in my work, I'm finding that transnational migrants often look to those quotidian objects because it allows them simply to settle into a quotidian world where they feel that it's not anymore about those issues of choice and power, that enable in some way simply to be quotidian themselves. And often that desire to be merely ordinary amongst the ordinary is what actually migrants are often striving for.
And perhaps because that, or for your recent words, that particular thing that I learned that often, like mobile phone money transaction or Facebook, that are also perhaps you mentioned Latour's work, they could be seen as, I don't know, as devices or something that are not just something that we can give or not mean, but they are also these small boxes that do things because they have a formula or some particular technology. So perhaps you send my next question, what is you as a foreigner, what do you do for your being? This what do you do? Or what is the challenge of studying transaction or studying social networks like Facebook? Like, what do you deal with them that are less material? So there are these types of devices or
there's a challenge there, right? Because, I mean, to me, the kind of approach that would see these things as black boxes or as devices that do certain kinds of work or that format the world in a certain way, to me, needs to always be seen as a question, not as the answer. Because it might be that they don't, right? I think sort of one of the problems with the kind of Latourian perspective is that the assumption tends to be that these things are devices and then we ask after their effects. When in fact the question should be first, you know, are these things black boxes or not? Are these things simply, you know, in what cases are things like accounting ledgers serving a rhetorical device? In what sense might they just be purely symbolic, not standing for anything, but just indexing themselves, as if to say, look, work has happened here. You have to worry about it. Even if no work is done on the wall, this is basically a kind of you know, ruse or a screen that's put up while other work goes on back there. There's so many different ways in which these so-called devices can function and operate that I think we need to, you know, maintain a kind of open-endedness to it when we encounter it. I think that that's sort of into my mind, the chief problem that I see with the use of some of these frameworks by people who take them to the field. So they assume they've got this new crowbar or a new lever that will just crack open and have all the answers, which then makes them want to find those answers instead of actually looking and seeing, you know, what's really there, being open to, you know, open to the open-endedness of the world, so to speak, and to the varied multiple ways in which some of these things play out often at the same time.
Yeah, and I think that you're asking really about how we kind of go from the studies of the kinds of materials in the sense we're represented there to these new, apparently immaterial or sort of digital, etc., kinds of worlds that we now encounter. And I think that, talk about this the other day, but actually that itself is illusion. We, as things first arise as innovations, we have a tendency to, I think, exaggerate the kind of unprecedented aspects and to imagine that these actually are somehow, for example, immaterial. But then we look at them more closely, which I think, well, actually are. What is this really immaterial at all? In fact, cell phones,